This young lady asked me a question the other day, and I know it's a question that people ask forever. This map up here I've used for 45 years, stood in front of one, from the seminary through every church I've ever pastored, and I've used it as an illustration so people can understand God's Word better. Now, where are we on this chart in space and time right now? Where?
The church age.
All right, we're in the church age. This is the church age. Mm-hmm. Where are we?
Near the end of
the church age. All right. We know we're in the end of the church age. Why, Brother Ed? What's God's thermometer in the world today? Israel. The nation of Israel. At the beginning of the church age, the Lord called out His church from the seashores of Galilee, and He established it. It was baptizing people. It had the Lord's Supper. It had thousands of members in it. It also, what was the first gift placed in the church, Marilyn?
Apostles.
Yeah, all of this stuff was there. Okay? Already in that church. On the day of Pentecost, that church received power to carry out the gospel. Now, Israel rejected her king and her kingdom. Israel was promised a kingdom. That kingdom is over here. And that kingdom will last for 1,000 years upon the earth. It will be a real, literal kingdom. A lot of people don't believe in that. Okay? But it's really going to be, we have many, many, just hundreds of scriptures referring to that period of time. And it is real. And there are real people. And they're going to go in their real bodies. And they will populate the earth for 1,000 years. And Israel will be the administrators of that kingdom for that 1,000 years. Many theologians believe that David, King David, will be resurrected and that he will be there on the throne in Jerusalem. And the Lord, his son, the Lord said to my Lord, remember that scripture? That his Lord will be in heaven upon his throne in New Jerusalem. Now, Israel was going to be dispersed, and it was, 36:16 through 19, May the 14th, 1948. According to Ezekiel 36:20-24, Israel began to be called back into the nation, into the land. Now, we see all of this in periods of time. Back in eternity past, God said, God wrote, if you are born again, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, or if you ever will in your life, the Lord wrote your name down in His Lamb's Book of Life in eternity past before He ever created anything, angels or anything material. Because there are three attributes of God. Three attributes. I'm going to bring them down in very clear, common terms. He is all-knowing. That's omniscient. He is all-power. That's omniscient. And what else? He is omnipresent. He's everywhere. Because He is omniscient, He wrote your names down in the Lamb's Book of Life. If you know Him, repent of your sins, and ask Him to save your soul. He knew that in eternity past. That's God. Now, this young lady, you asked me a question about heaven and hell the other day. Now, I went to Genesis 1 and 1 and 1 and 2. It said, in beginnings, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth, she had become formless and void. And then it says, Spirit God went out suffering over, mourning over His destroyed creation, according to Ezekiel 28 and Isaiah 14. Satan, Lucifer, destroyed it, and then God put it back together. Now, there's where we have fossil fuel and all the different things in the earth. Geological disruptions happened back that time. When I see things like here in Fish Lake Valley, where you see all of this tremendous amount of period of time. I've been in Cave Springs up here. They say there's 6,000 years of occupation in that cave. Now, God created the heavens and the earth a long time ago. He created man about 6,000 to 10,000 years ago. And I say that marginally because we don't, the chronographs that God, you know, people use the Bible by. Brother Ed, did you know that according to the Septuagint, when Jesus was born, that was the 8,000th year. See, we have different chronological times. They believe that he's going to come forth on the 7,000 and rule in the 8. Okay? Well, all of this we have, and we had Augustine, you know, the church fathers, and they began replacement theology, and also what they call, they replaced Israel with the church, and that Israel was done away with, and the church was different. You know, it was taken over, all the promises of the kingdom of it, and that the kingdom of God would be only in the hearts of those believers. And Augustine, that, and he was a great student of Plato. He Platonized the scriptures. Okay? Now, I'm telling you a lot of things that are very deep and everything, but there's things out there. I'm just telling you these things so you will know they're there. Okay? And you think about them. Like I said, my teachers, when I went to the seminary so many years ago, they say, just if you can't understand this now, just stick it under your hat and thaw it out 20 years from now, and maybe you can start to unthaw it and understand it. Now, heaven, this is Hashemayim, or heaven up here, Umaronois, and this is Hades, or Sheol, down here. And this is the earth right here. Now, the Bible says that Hades is a Tata Hippo. I'm not saying that just to be smart, because I teach Greek and Hebrew. Tata means down, and Hippo means what? When you've got hypoglycemia, what do you have? Low blood sugar. All right. When you have a hyperbole, what do you have? An exaggeration. Jesus used exaggeration sometimes. Exaggerate for a purpose as a figure of speech. Katahipo, it says katahipo gates, that hell or Sheol or Hades is down under the earth. Now, there are three heavens according to the Bible. Muhammad's got 7 of them. He's just about 4 too many. But the earth is here, and above the earth, right above the earth, is what we call the atmosphere. That's a Greek word, atmosphere, atmosphere. Atmosphere means what? In the atmosphere, what do we have? We have clouds, and we have a wind, and we have oxygen. And that's the first heaven, number one. And then out here, further, we have all the galaxies, all the stars that have ever been created. And up here at nighttime, you can see them when the night is clear, like you can reach out and touch those stars. But they're all out there, and there's suns, there's galaxies, and everything out there. And like I said last Sunday night, it says, Barashith bara Elohim et hashamayim v'ha'aretz. That's the Hebrew translate, or the Hebrew Bible. In beginnings, in one of the beginnings, God created the hashamayim, the heavens, and the earth. Now, where it says Hashemayim there, it really means uplifted waters. And I told you that the earth originally had an ocean in the sky. It was a whole bubble around the earth. And that the earth was all land and all water like that. And all the scientists will tell you that's the way the earth was. It's called Pangaea or Gondwana. Okay? And then it says in the days of Peleg, where were the days of Peleg up here? Right here. Right after the flood, in the days of Peleg, because they were supposed to scatter and multiply, and what did they do at the Tower of Babel? They conglomerated and built a big city and tall tower, and they built that tower all the way up into the, way up high, into the heavens. First heaven, in the atmosphere. And they worshipped pagan gods, and they worshipped Nimrod and his mother. This is the second heaven where all the stars are, okay? The Hashemayim. And then way up here in the third heaven, and the Bible says it is the north part of the earth. You go up to the north of there and ascend out into the third heaven. And that is the abode of God, okay? Now the Bible says in Genesis 3:15 that God's going to send His only Son, His Son, the seed of a woman. And this is very beautiful. Now, I've had a lot of doctors in my classes over the years, and I still do. And I said this, referred to this the other night, that not one drop of the blood of the mother goes into the child. It's the father. Now, Adam, God says, and this is something else beautiful. The Hebrew Bible is tremendous. It's dynamic. It's a powerful thing. It is a language of power and creation. The Bible says, and now what the translation said, that God formed man from the dust of the earth in the King James Version and all the others. But it doesn't say that in the original language. He formed him from the elements like he formed the dust. Man. From like he formed the dust. Man wasn't made from a mud ball. He's made from the same elements that he made the earth from and were related to the earth. And that's how God is going to redeem the earth back to himself. Okay? The seed of the woman. Now, Mary was a virgin. The Bible says that. She had not known man at all. The Holy Spirit came upon her, and Jesus said that, and John 1:14 says that God impregnated Mary with his blood and his life. And therefore, we could have a virgin-born Savior without sin, because the sin nature is passed on through the man, not the woman. And that was the fulfillment of it. Now, let me tell you something else here that so many people look across. In Genesis 3:15, who's talking there, Brother Eddie? Who's speaking mainly? Jehovah God, isn't it? Jehovah God. And he's directly speaking to, in Genesis 3:15, who's he speaking to?
The woman and the serpent.
The serpent, especially. Actually, the serpent is just the embodiment of the spirit of Lucifer, or Satan. He's using the serpent's body. And the serpent walked up on legs at that time. He was one of the most beautiful creatures. And many theologians say that he is the king of all the animal creatures. He was the king of all the animal kingdom. Okay? And he abused him. And that Satan voluntarily gave his body to Lucifer, Satan, to use to deceive the woman. Now the woman was taken out of man. It says God put man in a deep hypnotic trance. Now, the people do operations with hypnosis, and this goes back 4,000 years in history. God put a deep hypnotic trance on Adam, and he says he took, and it also says, now it says, took his rib and made woman. But in the original language, it took from his sides. They used the word rib originally because rib is sides, isn't it? Is that your side, your ribs? Ribs, okay, that's your sides. So they said, well, we'll just say rib. Instead of saying sides and bones, we're just going to say rib. But it really means he took from his sides, all of his sides. And he took all of feminine man from man. Ish is the word for man, and ishah is the word for woman. Woman means out of man, literally, in all languages. He took from her his sides and his fleshes and his bloods, literally. And he took that from man before man ever sinned. And who was the head of the human race? Adam. Now, if anything bad happened on this earth, whose fault was it? God told Adam to guard the garden. By the way, the word garden, Eden, means pleasure palace. It means a pleasure garden. It means dainties. God planted dainties in there. How many of you ever gone to real fancy banquets where they had hors d'oeuvres? That's the word for dainties. That's the word for Eden. These fancy foods, these little pieces of foods they give you. And that's the word for Eden. And that was and God planted Eden in the east of the earth. He planted Eden there. God planted that garden. By the way, how many Edens were there in the Bible, Marilyn?
Three.
How many?
Three.
Two.
Oh, two. Okay.
Who was in the first Eden? Who was in the first Eden? Who was the Eden, by the way, is the throne room.
Okay.
It's the throne room. Eden is the throne room. The person that was on the throne in the first Eden was Lucifer. And he lost his estate. Peter tells us about that. Jude tells us about it. And there were one third of the angels in the spirit world went with him when he rebelled against God. But Eden was his throne room. And then God built another Eden. And he placed Adam as the king of this world. And told him to guard it. Who's he going to guard it from? Who's he going to guard it from? The same dude that gave God trouble all this time, he's going to guard it from him. So when sin came in the garden, whose fault was it? It wasn't a woman's fault. It was a man's fault. And so it was Adam's fault because he was the leader of the human race. And so woman, it says, was not responsible for that sin, even though, and this is another thing. The Hebrew Bible is a very intensive language, okay? And it has tenses. It has stems, verb stems, and tenses, and voices, and modes, and things, and persons, singular and plural, all of that. It said that the woman took from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and she kept on taking and kept on eating it. Have you ever got something sometime that tasted so good that you just kept eating and you just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger and just kept on eating and kept on eating? That's what she did. And she gave it to her husband and he kept on eating it until it was gone. That tree must have tasted pretty good, Eddie. But they got indigestion. Very bad indigestion. That indigestion was that they had sinned. And now they had begun the process of dying. And now they had known they had become arum. That's the word for they had become thieves. They were thieves, weren't they? What was the only thing they weren't supposed to have in their garden? Don't touch or don't take from that tree. It's my tree. I'm going to teach you everything you need to know. You'll know everything that tree is about. But I will give it to you a little at a time. But not from that tree. That tree's mine. And so Satan nests around there in the Nahash. Say Nahash. Nahash. That's the word. That means deceiving serpent, Nahash. So he uses this serpent's body, and the serpent loans his body to him, to deceive the woman. Not the man, the woman. He's going to get the man through the woman. So he deceives the woman. The woman's still without sin, but without the ability to pass on the sin nature to the child, because that's in the father. Or the father of human race, mankind, human men. Because she was taken out of man before he sinned. Now, if she had been taken out of man after he sinned, guess what? It had that taint of sin in her, which she would pass on. Then God couldn't bring his son into the world. Don't ever stop studying. Don't be afraid to study science, medicine, archaeology, geology, or anything else. If it's true, it will agree with the Bible. Many people try to make the Bible teach something that it does not teach. But it'll teach this, and this is a beautiful thing. When does the blood change and begin to coagulate in the human body when a child is born? After he's born?
Death.
Huh?
Death is when it coagulates.
No, well, I mean, when does it begin to coagulate? When will it, if you get cut, when is it going to begin to coagulate? On the eighth day. Guess when God told Abraham to circumcise his children from then on? On the what? The eighth day. Medical science will tell you that. They didn't know that back then. God did. Because he made it. Alright? Now this woman, she took and she kept on giving to her husband this tree until it was ate plumb down. Plumb ate up. Ed up. Okay? It's gone. And then here comes God walking. Here comes Jehovah Jesus in his pre-incarnate form walking into the garden. And he says, "What? Adam, where are you?" Now, God is omniscient, isn't he? God knew where Adam was. But did Adam know where he was? No. He was about to find out. Because he had fear that he never had before. He had terror in his heart because he was a sinner. You sin against God when you've been born again, and guess what happens? You will have terror in your heart. I preached a sermon a long time ago, and a preacher preached this about 500 years ago. A man may sin securely, but safely never. If you're born again, then nothing's going to put you in hell. But I'll guarantee if you want to sin in this world, just being rebellious against God, you're walking on dangerous ground. God will work you over because you're his child. Before you're his child, you can do whatever you want to. But after you're his child, it's a different story. He will put you back in line somehow. Well, so he said to the woman, he said to man, and directly to Satan, Jehovah God did. He said, I will put active hatred between your seed. Who's your seed there, Brother Eddie? He's talking to Satan, isn't he? All right? Is Satan going to have a son?
Yes.
Yeah? Going to have a son?
Antichrist.
Yeah. Going to have a son. He's going to have a literal son. Between your seed and between her seed. Now, in the book of Enoch, it always doesn't talk about the seed of the son of man. It always talks about the son of woman. Because it's looking about that Genesis 3 thing, the promise of the woman. I will put active hatred between your seed and her seed, and he shall bruise you as to the heel, and you shall bruise, or he shall bruise you as to the head, and you shall bruise him as to the heel. In other words, this world will deal Jesus at the crippling blow, which was on the cross of Calvary. Right here. Now let's go back to Hades and Sheol. We got this straightened out. Right here is when he would have a crippling blow. Jesus suffered all the pains of hell in this life. From the betrayal, from hunger, from thirst, from whippings, beatings, and the nails through his hands. And by the way, there's where they put the nails. Not in his hands, but here. This is your carpal tunnel area. Guess what goes through here? All the nerves. They would put a washer on those Roman nails and put them right through the carpal tunnel, which hurt like mad. I fell down today, down there over there by the laundromat, hit my knee and that part of my arm and this part of my arm and that part right there, I hit that carpal tunnel and my hand was just like electricity in it. And then my knee didn't feel very good either because I worked it over. He was steel down there. My leg, I'm not a man of steel, you know, I'm fragile. Fragile. It hurt a lot. But every time I feel a pain like that, I imagine what Jesus felt like on the cross of Calvary for those 6 hours. That seemed like an eternity. You know how long Jesus suffered on that cross? How long did he suffer on the cross? Huh?
6 hours.
6 hours. But how long did he suffer on that cross? From the very eternal ages in space and time back then. It says Jesus what? Suffered the agony as the lamb slain from the what? Foundation. From before the foundation of earth. How long did Jesus suffer for your sins? All the way from eternity past. All the way to the cross of Calvary. And there's where they were laid on him in space and time. In space and time. That's what happened. Now, we talked about the earth. We talked about the first heaven, the second heaven, the third heaven, which is Hashemayim or Oranois, or this is the abode and the throne room of God up there. Now, we're from right here, eternity past, and now we have the creation of man in a state of innocence. And what was he supposed to do? Do not eat. But he did eat. They ate, Genesis 3, 1 through 6. The curse came upon them, Genesis 3:15, but the promise also. The judgment, they began to die. And all their children began to die. They lived over 900 years. Eve probably had 1,000 children and had them in multiple births. A woman can have 1,000 children. She's capable of it. She just don't have time. But Eve did. And all of all of mankind come from that womb of that woman. Right there. And there were thousands of people on the earth and they started having children too. Maybe when they're 100 years old or 50 years old or 80 years old, they began. And remember, the earth was all different back then because we had an ocean in the sky filtering out the sunlight. After the flood, that's when men began to live shorter lives. And some of them are recorded after that, 180, 175, whatever. But they still didn't live long lives. How old, Marilyn? Jochebed and Amram. Who are they? Jochebed and Amram. Who knows that? Jochebed and Amram. That's Moshe, Moses' mother and father. Now, she was 120, according to the book of Jasher, she was 128 years old when he married her. See, people were still living pretty long right then. She was 128 years older, and she was his aunt. She was Amram's aunt. She was his father's sister. Now, remember, all of these laws about marriage and getting given in marriage come when? Way over here to the wall. That's hundreds of years difference, isn't it? All right? So anyway, here we have the confusion of languages and the division of the earth, the continents divide. And here we have Abraham. And way over here, we have the Egyptian bondage for 400 years. And then we have Moses and Aaron. Moses' mother was 128 years old, and she was the aunt of the man she married. They lived still pretty long then, but their lives were short compared to over here on this side. Just throwing a little bit of information. Just think about this. Look it up. Check it out. Now, here on the earth, God decided to redeem the whole universe back to himself. John 3:16, who can quote that for me? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have everlasting life. For God so loved what?
The cosmos.
The cosmos. The whole world. Now remember when I told you that God didn't create man from dirt. He created him from the same elements as dirt, related to the dirt. Okay? Now if he had created him from dirt, what kind of a creation would it have been, Brother Eddie? You remember? When you create something from something else, what kind of creation is that? That's what we call a secondary creation. When you make a piece of furniture out of a tree, it is a secondary creation. God made man a primary creation right straight from him. He come from the elements of him, was created from God himself. That's how the earth was created. Okay, brother? You got that one? Primary creation. But where was the woman come from? Secondary creation from man. Man is still the head of the human race. Man is still responsible for everything that happens on the earth. Now, some women will disagree with that. That's okay, because they have been doing that for 6,000 plus years. Okay. Here we have mankind on the earth. Now, God's going to redeem the earth and all the stars and everything back to him. Okay? He's going to do all this. But in space and time is when it is valid. Valid. How many of you planned on getting a driver's license when you were about 10 years old? I started driving when I was about 6. I was driving tractor up here in Fish Lake Valley when I was 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 years old. My uncles would take me down to Los Angeles when I was in Bakersfield, take me down to San Fernando, a galloping Ford, and they'd put me in a car when I was about 10, 11 years old as they drive it to Bakersfield. I didn't have a valid driver's license at all. Okay. Now, all of these people back here, from here, we have Adam. Do you think Adam believed? Do you think he believed God after he was lost, after he became lost? Did he come back to God? Yeah. But was his salvation valid? No. How about over here to Noah? Did Noah believe God? Noah believed God. Did Abraham believe God? Now, these people are all saved by grace, but it's only on a promise because it's not valid yet. Now, here, everybody that died that was ever born on this earth went down here. This is called Sheol or Hades. Sheol means the place asked about. What king of Israel was asked for? What was his name? Asked for? What was the king of Israel that was asked for? Saul. Saul meant asked for. They asked for a king, they got one. God always planned to give him a king, because he's David. But they prematurely asked for one because he was so tall and so powerful and so handsome. And they said, give us a king like the rest of the nation. They said, I'm going to give you one, but it's going to be David. But they rejected God, and God gave them Saul. Place asked about Sheol. Hades is the place not seen. How many have ever gone and looked at hell and come back to tell about it? Nobody really. The place not seen. But every one of these believers and non-believers all the way here went to Sheol. Now Sheol here, there's a place called paradise, and there's a place called the place of torments. Over here. Paradise is a word that came all the way from the Persian language. The Persian language, it means a guarded pleasure park. And that garden originally was a guarded pleasure park. Who was supposed to guard that garden? Adam. Now who guards this garden, this pleasure park? God does. Okay? This is paradise. It goes from Persian into Hebrew, and it's Paris, or Paradiso in Greek, Paradiso in Latin, and it's never translated. It comes over in English as paradise. It means guarded pleasure park. The people that are saved go down here on this side, and they have much pleasure, much eating and food, whatever. Whatever they need is there provided. Now, they're not in any physical bodies. When you die, where does your body go? You can go out here in Fish Lake Valley, right over here at the cemetery, and you can find Asa Wiles' body down there and all the guys he shot. Those guys followed him all the way from Lydon. Followed him down here, and they got in a gunfight out there, and he killed all of them, but he died from the gunshot wounds, too. All of them are planted over there. But I'm going to tell you, their spirits and their souls are not there. It's not there. Now, we got people that don't believe in hell at all. They don't believe in hell at all. They don't. Okay? And they say when you die, you go to sleep. And the Bible says that you fall asleep in Jesus, you fall asleep, you go together to your family. What part of you falls asleep? The body. The soul does not sleep. The spirit does not sleep. We are triune. We're made in the image of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, there aren't three gods, they're triune God. Here we have body, we have soul, and we have spirit. We're triune. The spirit is what gives you life. The soul is where you live. Your memory, your thoughts, your hates, your loves, your pain and all that. That's your soul. And in Hebrew, it's nephesh. 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 And that's a little word like this. Nephesh. Now all animals have souls. Animals think. You ever watch a bird think? You ever watch a dog think? Cat think? You set them out there. Cats will train you. Yeah. You don't train cats. Cats train you. They're smarter than people sometimes, I think. They think. Dogs can teach you tricks. They do. They'll teach you things. Well, they have souls. Yes, Brother Eddie.
They have the soul, but they weren't given the likeness of God, which would
No, they're not made in the likeness of God.
They don't have an eternal spirit.
I don't know.
The Bible doesn't say one way or the other.
It doesn't say one way or the other. I can just tell you one thing, that they think. They have souls, they have spirit, and they have flesh. That's all I can tell you. Whether you see your pets in heaven, people ask me that all the time. I said, I don't know. It's not impossible, but I can't tell you anything. All I can tell you is that they're triune. Angels are triune. They have bodies. They have what we call spiritual body. They can go from dimension to dimension, but they have form. They have form. Spirits do not. Angels do. That's pneumatology. That's a whole new study. Angiology and pneumatology. Well, everybody died. If they were saved, they went over here. If they believed. If they were lost and rebellious, they went over here. Now, Luke, the 16th chapter, we have what we call a love letter from hell. I have written that. I've preached that sermon, a love letter from hell. A man died. In the original language, it says his name was Dives or Nineveh. And there was Lazarus died, and he was a very poor man, and he suffered a lot. He had maybe leprosy or staph infection or something else, and evidently died of it. at this rich man's gate, which the rich man, like I said, his name was Dives or Nineveh. Now, Lazarus got to go to heaven, not because he was poor, because he believed. And, well, he didn't really go to heaven. He went to paradise. Okay? Paradise. And then Lazarus' buddy over here, where he sat at his gate, Nineveh, he goes to Sheol, Hades, all right, but he's in the place of torment. And he's over there, and he looks over there. Somehow, one of the torments in Hades is that he could look over here and see these people having a good time and eating and drinking. And he asked Abraham, which was there also, he said, Abraham, send Lazarus with one drop of water with his finger to cool this tongue. Now, does your soul have form? What was in that Hades, Brother Eddie, if it didn't have form?
It was spirit.
But did it have form? Did it feel?
Obviously.
Did it thirst?
Did it?
All right. All of these things. Now, I don't know. This is something else I don't know all about. I just tell you it's there. Okay? People think that I can answer any question in the Bible. I can't. They had a birthday party for me about, 14 years ago? And one of my students asked the pastor to ask me a question. Asked me a question that I couldn't answer. I can't answer a lot of questions. But they thought that I could answer anything. And then one of them said, it was a Jewish guy, he said, B'nai ha'elohim, like that to me. Tell me about that. And I didn't want to tell him. I said, I'll talk to you later about it. You know, like that. But we talked about Genesis 6 chapter, the sons of God. And so he told me later on, he said, I thought he was a skirting issue. I said, no, I didn't want to ask this because it was too complicated. And so he asked me to go out for lunch with him one day, and I spent an hour and a half telling him about the sons of God. And he's just jumping up and down. He said, he's a doctor. He's a brain surgeon. Just jumping up and down while I was telling him about this. It took me an hour and a half to answer that question. Sons of God.
Those are angels, by the way.
Well, anyway, all these people were down here. Now, their salvation is not valid yet. That's why they're here, in this holding place. Now, some people say that's how purgatory was invented. Purgatory didn't have anything to do with that. All right? Once you're here, now, when is hell put in order, Brother Ed? Look up here on this map, every one of you. When is hell? After the great white throne judgment, after the 1,000-year reign of Christ, then we have the resurrection of the lost. Now they're resurrected from Hades over here. And they're put in their bodies and they stand before God. And Jesus judges them. Now, right here, these people here, God could not redeem them legitimately and with validity until Jesus Christ died on the cross of Calvary. Okay? So, at the cross of Calvary, where did Jesus go? Where did his soul and spirit go? His body went in the grave and it looked like it was asleep, didn't it? But was he asleep? No. He went down here to the paradise side of Hades and he preached to these, and some of them were disobedient in Noah's time, and guess where they were, Brother Eddie? These disobedient people in the days of Noah. They're on the outside of the ark, dying, because they didn't believe. Okay? Now, there was a promise here. God made a promise, and God's promises are beautiful, and they will be validated, but they weren't validated for thousands of years until Jesus was born. The seed of the woman, not man, the seed of the woman. The seed of the woman came into this earth. And the first thing Satan did was try to kill him, didn't he? Who did he use first?
Herod
the Great. Herod the Great. Who put Herod on the throne, Meryl? Who put Herod on the throne? Joseph was supposed to be on the throne, remember, later on. Joseph's family, his father, should have been on the throne. Who put Herod on the throne? Anybody know? Have you ever heard of Antony and Cleopatra? Antony and Cleopatra put Herod on the throne. And he built this Jerusalem like a Roman city, and he built one thing, the Antonio. Antonio is named after who? Anthony. Anthony. Mark Anthony. Antonio. Fortress, Antonio Fortress. And he built a hippodrome where they had horse races and everything there in Jerusalem. Okay. Just like Romans. He was what we call, and the Bible says, the king of Israel is going to be from whose loins? From whose loins?
David's.
David's. And who was David's great-great-grandfather? Who was David's great-great-grandfather over in this period of time? Jacob. And then God changed Jacob's name to what? Israel. Now, Jacob's father was what? Yitzchak. Yitzchak is his name. We call it Isaac. Yitzchak. And it means pleasurable. Pleasure is what it means. Yitzchak means pleasure, like laughing, kissing, what all. That's all Yitzchak. And that old boy, his God was in his belly. He had two boys. One was an ungodly buzzard, and his name was what? Esau, Harry. Esau. His name was Esau, and then he had one son that was a big, powerful man, and his name was Jacob. Right? And God said that he told Rebekah who was going to be the greatest one, didn't he? She was having terrible pains, and those children were wrestling in her womb, and she spoke to Jehovah God, and she said, "What's going on?" And he said, "There are two nations in your womb. The firstborn will serve the latter." The firstborn is going to be the rejection. That's what we call the rejection of the firstborn. That's Esau. Whose son was Herod? Esau's son. Who'd the devil get on the throne of Israel? Esau's son. Not God's son. And it's called the nation of Israel, but who's ruling it? The wrong man, the wrong lineage. And those Jews, he killed all of the Levites, he killed the priests, he killed the Sanhedrin court, and guess where some of them escaped to? Down to the Qumran caves. Those are illegitimate ones. And they wouldn't recognize anything up there in Jerusalem. All they said, they were a bunch of, they were horrible people. Horrible people. And John the Baptist called them what? A brood of vipers. Sons of Satan. He could look into their hearts and see who they were. Sons of Satan. And Jesus said in Matthew, "Oh, you Pharisees, scribes, and hypocrites." You Pharisees, scribes, and hypocrites. He denounced them, didn't he? If you read Pontius Pilate's letter, it's a historical record, you will find Pontius Pilate saying, "Jesus, please, please, take back off on these people just a little bit. They're going to try to kill you, and they're trying already saying that I'm in cahoots with you because I'm letting you preach. Please back off." He said, "O Prince of the earth, when the Son of Man comes before you one of these days, there's nothing you can do to save me because it's foreordained and predestined to happen. There's nothing you can do, and they have the greater sin." Remember when Pontius Pilate five times declared that Jesus was innocent? What did he do the last time? He got a basin of water, washed his hands, and said, "I am innocent of this innocent man's blood." And they said what? "Let his blood be upon us and our children." Did it happen? Yep. They had the wrong king on the throne. They were doing everything wrong. And God offered them the kingdom, and they rejected the king and the kingdom. So God set them aside for a while. They got to suffer a lot. Did they suffer? "Let his blood be upon us and our children." They'll suffer all the way to the tribulation period. And right in the middle of this, they're going to really be upset because two-thirds of them are going to be killed. But five-sixths of the whole world is going to be killed too. Now, when Jesus went down to Sheol, how long was he down there? 3 days. 3 nights. Jesus said to the Jews, they demanded a sign, didn't they? And he said, "I'm going to give you no sign except what? The sign of Jonah. For the man, the the Son of Man will be in the earth for 3 days and three nights. And I want you to do something else too. How many of you thought about old Jonah? Jonah was a reluctant prophet. He was a scoundrel. He didn't want to do what God... Is that something reminds me of me, I think, sometimes. He was over there, and God told him to go up to Nineveh. Here's the Mediterranean Sea over here, and he lives up there not too far from Nazareth in Bethlehem. And right up here is about 600 miles up there. Where'd he go? He jumps a ship over here at Joppa and takes off for Spain. About 3,000 miles the other direction. Now, Nineveh is landlocked, isn't it? Is it? So God causes a storm and causes great fish and all this kind of stuff. And the crew on the ship, they all get saved, by the way. Everybody that Jonah preaches to gets saved. That reluctant prophet, everybody he preaches to gets saved. Foreordination and predestination, Brother Eddie. It really is true there. He said finally they drew lots and they were in fear of Jehovah. And he says, it's my fault. I'm running from God. Throw me into the water. They said, oh no. If your God is this powerful, we sure not going to offend him. And so they pray and they throw everything off the ship and everything. It's a pretty big ship. And the water's coming in, and the waters are getting rougher and rougher and rougher and rougher and rougher. And finally, they threw him over, and instantly it calmed down. And every one of them prayed to Jehovah God and got saved, and they offered sacrifices to Jehovah right there. The job was done. What happened to Jonah? He went down and he drowned. Read the book of Jonah. He drowned. He died. And then a great fish, a dog is what it is in Hebrew, a big fin swallowed him. And he prayed from Sheol to Jehovah God. And Jehovah God sent that fish, or Leviathan, or whatever it was, either by air or by land, because if you're going to go and swim all the way around, you've got to swim all the way around the whole continent of Africa, all the way up into the Indian Ocean, and all the way up in the Persian Gulf, and up that Tigris and Euphrates River, until you come over there by the Tigris and go up there, and there he spits him out on the shore, or else he sends him over land. I don't know. And guess who those Ninevites were worshiping? Dog. The fish gods. All right? And he spit him out on the shore alive. He was dead. God resurrected him and put him out there for this job. And then he got mad, didn't he? Jonah got mad when all of them got saved and sat out there and pouted to God. Pouted and pouted and pouted. That's the story. Now let's get back over here to paradise. Jesus is down here how long? 3 days. Three nights. And then he takes up, he's resurrected, and he appears to his disciples, and it says many of the saints were resurrected with him. Now, we don't know how many saints were resurrected here. Some people say all of them were resurrected that died. And they lived with God. When Jesus took them with him, they went up. What did old Nineveh or Dives ask? He said, I have five brothers, a love letter from hell. I have five brothers. Please send somebody back from the dead so they won't come to this terrible place. And he said, if one went back from the dead, they would not believe. They have Moses and they have the prophets. Let them hear them. Well, did some people go back from the dead? Did Jesus go back from the dead? Did some of the saints raise? Maybe some of them, maybe all of them. But now, since the price has been paid for in space and time, John 1:14 says, Kai ho logo starts again, so in Greek. And that's beautiful. And the word, the Jehovah there, that's Tadabar. This word in that's the word for Jehovah, the replacement word, because they were afraid to speak it. Exodus 20, verse 7, says, Thou shalt not use the Lord thy God's name in vain, for you will pay for it. And then we have the word ho, logos, in Greek, which is the exact equivalent of ha-davar. Okay? And here's the word Jehovah right there, which means he who shall become. Okay? That's what that name means. Now, they didn't say this name. We don't even know how to say it. Okay? Now, I want you to look at this word. Jehovah. Say that one. All right, Jehovah? Now, I'm going to show you how Hebrew is. Let's take out all the vowels. Now, actually, J is a vowel, so we're going to get rid of that. We're going to get rid of that one. We're going to get rid of that one. We're going to get rid of that one. Now, say that word. It's impossible, isn't it? Now, let's take the word Jesus. Let's take all the vowels out of it. And you try to say that one. Can't do it, can you? The Jews didn't know how to say that name because they hadn't used it. So they said, Ha the Bar. So when John wrote, it said, in the beginning, kept on being the Word, the Jehovah. And the Jehovah kept on being inseparable from the heart of God because Jehovah kept on being God. John 1:14 says, Kaiha Logos Sarks again. And the Word are the, what? Jehovah Sarks, flesh. He became and dwelt among us, and we beheld the glory as only glory from the side of the Father, full of grace and truth. John 1:18 says, no man has seen God at any time, the only begotten, what? God, the one being inseparable from the Father, that one has led himself out of space and time, out of eternity and the space and time, and give his life for us so that we could have eternal life, so that we could go to heaven. And he did it in space and time. He did it in space and time for us. Have you believed in Jesus Christ as your Savior? That he was really the God that came to redeem the whole world? That he came and died for you. He died for all man. We talked about get rid of something. We talked about TULIP the other day. We won't go into this very much. Total hereditary depravity, unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, and preservation of the saints. Now I believe. And total hereditary depravity, I believe in unconditional election. I do not believe in limited atonement. I do not believe in irresistible grace, but I do believe in preservation of the saints, and that one, and that one. And that's what you call sublapsarianism. Now there's supra, infra, and sublapsarian. And that is what we call Calvinism, and it's all different levels of Calvinism. A superlapsarian believes in total hereditary depravity, but it believes so much in total hereditary depravity that those that are created for damnation cannot believe. They're totally depraved. But those that are created for election, they cannot resist the grace of God. Now, Brother Eddie, is that a little bit contrary to the nature of God? Did God ever create anything bad? If he created the damned, if he created the reprobate, is he creating something bad? Is God capable of doing that? No. Not capable of it. It would totally destroy his nature. Limited atonement. That Jesus Christ only died for the elect. The death of Jesus Christ is only efficacious to the elect. But Jesus Christ died for every man's sins. They will not go to heaven for sin. You won't go to hell for sin. You won't go to hell for all the bad things you did in this world. You'll go to hell because you have rejected Jesus Christ as your Savior. That's the only thing that's going to get you in hell. That's the unpardonable sin. Irresistible grace. Can you resist the grace of God? Many people have. Preservation of the saints. Once you've been saved, can you get lost? That's not possible. Salvation is by grace only. Sublapsarian, infralapsarian, they don't believe in an actually irresistible grace. And they have a modified limited atonement. But the sublapsarians believe in hereditary depravity, this one, and they believe in this one. I have a chart. If you go to discovertheword.com and go down to the photo gallery, you'll see a chart there in class, Areopagus classroom photos, and you'll see that chart. And all the stages of Calvinism, I drew it up and did that. And I can't find one, Brother Eddie, to give it to you here. They're down in Bakersfield or Old River or someplace else. God did not reject you. If you go home rejecting God, it's going to be your fault. God's Son died for you. But you, God, gave your sovereign destiny to you to decide. God gave it to you to make up your mind where you're going to spend eternity. Where you're going to spend eternity. It's up to you. Jesus Christ died for your sins. He gave His life for you. The atonement is there. Do you want it or not? Do you want it or not? Thank you for your patience time with me. Thank you for allowing me to speak for you. I hope you got something from it. I hope you got something from it. Brother Eddie, it's yours.
Even afterwards.
Okay. He may not take an hour and a half to answer it, but there's no guarantee. That's fine.
And I might not be able to answer it too.
Yep. That's, we're always learning. Father, thank you. We praise you. You have given us a lot of meat to chew on here tonight. We don't understand everything, but we know that as we need it, your Spirit is very faithful to provide it. So we look to you for teaching, understanding.